Okay, good morning to everybody. We are very pleased to be here, and we thank the organizers for inviting us. My name is Giordana Gai. I'm from Sapienza University of Rome, and I share this presentation with Francesco, who will present the second part of the work. The presentation is focused on the methods to optimize the grid resolution and to check the reliability of the prediction that we make using fire models. And this is the outline of the presentation. I will introduce the motivation and objective of the presentation. I will review the methods and briefly the theoretical background behind them. And Francesco will show you some case studies and the conclusions. Very quickly to present myself, I'm a structural engineer. I graduated in Rome in 2014. After that, I started a PhD, and I submitted my thesis a few days ago on tunnel fire safety. And I collaborated for 2 years with the Italian Fire Brigade, and I worked occasionally as a fire practitioner. So, why is the grid resolution so important for our fire simulations? Well, because considering FDS, we know that FDS is a large energy simulation model, and so the equation that we are using are the filtered equations of the Navier-Stokes equation. So we introduce a filter, and the length of the filter is identical to the grid size in FDS. So from the very beginning, we know that FDS equations depends on the grid. But how we choose the grid? Normally, we have to do a balance between what is good according to the theory. So what is the most correct choice normally goes towards a fine grid. While on the other end, we have a limited amount of time. So normally, we need quick results. And so we would prefer to use coarse resolution to make prediction in a shorter time. So this balance is not easy. And so we decided to give them some aspect of these methods. So several methods can be used to optimize the grid resolution and ensure that the grid that we choose allows for obtaining reliable results. So I will talk about the ratio of the characteristic diameter and the grid size, the Y plus and the MPR. We will try to check them with some examples, and finally we will try to add another global quantities for the convergence check. So the first method is an a priori method. So what we normally use when we build our input file is to limit the ratio between the characteristic diameter and the grids and the grid size inside the range. Normally, is the range is 416, but we know that this range comes from an experimental test that has been checked with this resolution. And so this range is not necessarily satisfactory for this scenario and for our specific case. what I want to show here is that by refining the mesh, we have to take into account that the computational effort increase a lot. For example, if T course is the amount of time related to the coarse resolution, by halving each side of the cell, we increase the computational time by a factor of 16, because we have three times the factor of 2, which depends on the of halving the grid, the cell, and the factor of 2 that depends on the CFL condition of FDS. So the increase, the increment in the amount of time is significant. If we reduce to, for example, to a ratio of 16, the characteristic diameter and the grid side ratio. Other methods that can be used to check the quality of our simulation, one of these is concerns the Y plus. The Y plus is a non-dimensional parameter that is related to the resolution near the wall. So when we have to make prediction near the wall, it can be useful to check if this parameter is contained in a range. This range for typical fire is comprised in the range is 30,000. And what does it mean, this Y plus? Well, it's expressed in the first expression, and delta N is the length of the grid near the wall, and while delta B is a viscous parameter. And so the finer the grid near the wall, the lower the wave loss and the higher the resolution. And so the 30 is, for example, a value of wave loss of 30 is a very good resolution near the wall. And finally, another a posteriori method that can be used to check if the quality of our simulation is good is the MTR. Well, MTR is a measure of turbulence resolution and is expressed with this this relationship between the KSGS, that is the kinetic energy of the subgrid, and KLS is instead the calculated energy. So it's the part that is solved using our equation. So what does it mean? If MTR tends to zero, we are tending to DNS simulation. So the accuracy is very good. While, because we have no subgrid, so we are calculating all the field. While if this ratio tends to one, we are the parent part of our field is modeled instead of calculated. Normally, Pope says that a value of MTR below 0.2 is a good resolution. And so this is a good threshold to check if our model is reliable. However, the question is, does MTR below 0.2 imply reliable results? Because maybe I'm not interested in a very high accuracy of the flow field, but I'm interested in making prediction on the available safe egress time that are reliable. So I don't want to refine my grid and to obtain a different value of the available safe egress time. And another question could be, are we really able to guarantee this MTR below 0.2 along all the domain? Because the conditions in the fire compartment can be very different. For example, near fire field can be very different from the fire field, and so on. And often to answer the second question was made by Pope, that says that the only way to make less complete is to adapt the grid according to the measure of turbulence resolution. That is, I should be able to reduce appropriately the grid resolution where it is needed. So where, for example, the fire field, the field is more complicated. However, today, this can be done only with iteration. So normally what is what we do is to run a first simulation with a coarse grid and to run another simulation with a final grid near the fire, for example. And so this is not an automatic process. And just to become familiar with this quantity, we run some simulation on a very simple fire compartment with a single central valve and two openings in the lateral walls. So we analyzed two fire size, 2 and 4 megawatt, and three different grid size that were all in that range 416 that should be okay from what is commonly done, at least in Italy. And then after this, we run the simulation, we check those two parameters. So first the Y plus, and it was in that range 30,000 among all the three, for all the cases. However, by refining the mesh, we obtain a lower value of Y plus, and this is in agreement with the theory. Finally, we check the measure of turbulence resolution, and we obtain that in some cases, these histograms are related to the measure of turbulence resolution. These are many points that we checked, many location, and we obtain that by refining the mesh, the measure of turbulence resolution decreases until below the 0.2. So we were very confident about this result. However, when we check manually these trends, we obtain very different values, especially in the left case. And so my question was, okay, we check all the posteriori quality metrics that we have, but we still are not able to obtain overlapping trends. This was very negative. And so we try to make other evaluation, and
so, morning, I'm Francesco, and I'm a fire practitioner. There's not so much to say. I work from 3 years in an engineering firm. This is called William Partners. And the first time that we ran this grid sensitivity for that case study, we realized that we need a way to say if refining the grid, the solution are going to be similar and similar. So we try to evaluate the Pearson coefficient between each grid spacing. The Pearson coefficient is a linear measure of the correlation between two variables. When the Pearson coefficient is one, then the correlation is strong. When the Pearson coefficient is zero, then there are no relation between the variables. So we try to analyze the dispersion diagram. And we found that when the Pearson coefficient is very high, then there is a high correlation. And this means that the results are comparable. And we tried then to use this parameter to find if refining the grid, the Pearson coefficient is going to grow up. And if the Pearson coefficient is going to grow up, then the parameter are supposed to converge. This is not so simple, but this was the main idea. So we started from this factory building case study. This is a more complex application. We chose that one because it's something that we faced very frequently in our practitioner life. This is a concrete building. There are a lot of this concrete building in Italy. This is a factory building. And we choose this one because of the complexity of the ceiling. So the ceiling is low. There are a lot of beams. And this could create a lot of eddies and turbulence in the when the smoke is spread and in the ceiling jet. We placed the proper burner. We didn't focus so much about which burner choose because it's outside the scope of work of this presentation, but we choose a proper one. We follow the Italian fire prevention code, and the heat release rate's maximum is 50 megawatt, and the fire draw rate is 75 seconds, so it's ultra fast. We test three grid resolution. We start from a very coarse one, 100 centimeter, and we arrived at 25 centimeter. This is the final one. Obviously, simulation by simulation, the computational cost change a lot. We can start from 4 hours for 100 centimeter grid resolution, arriving at 141 hour for the 25 centimeter grid resolution. And we also placed the devices of the most important parameter in 60 different positions. And we choose three, we decided to place the devices in three different levels. We examined, first of all, we evaluated the Y plus the boundaries in order to check the reliability of the results. And the results are really clear this time, because the Y plus maximum for the grid spacing of 100 centimeter exceeds three times the limit of the user guides. So the results are supposed to be really unreliable. For the 25 centimeter grid spacing, the results are always below the limits declared by the user guide. And for the 50 centimeter grid spacing, we can see that the most of the results are below the 1000 value defined by the user guide. We tried to analyze also the measure of turbulence. Each row is a different level where we place the devices. For example, we can see that level by level, the results are slightly different. For example, in the upper layer, the measure of turbulence is close to one. That means that the three grid spacing that we choose are not doesn't give a reliable result in terms of representation of the complexity of the turbulence behavior. These are the results of the Y plane that is represented. These are the results for the X plane. And we can see that for the first and second level, there are some results that are close to one. And these are the results that are placed on the fire burner. And for the far field, for the devices that are placed far from the fire source, the measure of turbulence is more or less always below the 0.2 level declared by the POP criterion and by the user guide. So we try to do also a grid sensitivity analysis. This time we have 240 different devices that were placed in the model. That means that we have to do 240 grid sensitivity assessment. This is a huge data, and so we try to use a kind of filter that can tell us if refining the grid, the solution are going to be more similar. And what we did was a kind of algorithm that used the Pearson coefficient and the mean error, and that can tell us if the solution is going to converge or not. We checked manually this filter, and we found that it worked for this case study. So we are not sure if it works for us case study, but it worked very good for this one. And the percentage of the result that are supposed to converge is the 80%. And we also found that the 50 centimeter grid spacing is supposed to be representative. Is supposed to be representative for the solution that we found, and on the safe side. In conclusion, we can say that the Y plus assessment points out that the 100 centimeter grid spacing should be avoided in the near field, in the near wall field. That the measure of turbulence resolution assessment points out that the grid should be refined in the upper layer volume and in the fire plume zone. The piston correlation coefficient could be a good parameter in order to assess if the solution don't have appreciable differences. And the grid sensitivity study of the factory building model shows that 5 centimeter grid spacing could be used. But there should be future developments. because this convergence filter is just a place to start. We should improve that in order to evaluate if the grid spacing is on the safe side, considering the objective of our performance-based design approach. We would like to improve that, placing some consideration of the computational cost. And this filter should be tested in a lot of different case studies in order to find if there are limits for the use of the correlation Pearson coefficients. Thank you for the attention.
It's always worth a question, sorry, I could explain some arguments. What we used to do was resolve, increase the resolution,
yes,
and see how the results at a certain point changed, and if we got a convergence,
yes,
or something which was sensible. It seemed that you were getting very different results on with the resolutions you looked at. So I would intuitively say you've not got anywhere near a resolved solution, although you've got a large number of cells. The other way that we used to historically test for grid resolutions was changing the differencing method. So do you have a control on the differencing method you use? Like we found upwind differencing with the fine mesh was better than the second order differencing, because in the second order difference, the leading error term is third order, which is disruptive. And it caused numerical instability. But did you look at different differencing schemes, and are you anywhere near a resolution that you found satisfactory?
Actually,
and how do you know that?
Yes, we actually didn't look at this aspect. This was something a little bit outside our scope of work, but obviously we would like to check and try to assess also this. And
but it seems, just carrying on, it just seems that even with the finest grid, you don't have a grid independent solution.
Yeah.
So
yes. So you are far away from,
yes,
an ideal situation.
Yes.
And that would apply to most cases, although not wanting to convince everyone that it's always wrong.
We at the beginning we start evaluating this grid solution using also the rule of thumb that Jordan explained previously.
Mm-hmm.
And our file size was in the limits of this rule of thumb. But at the end we found that what happens in the previous case studies, this one. Was that the results were not so similar. But what we tried also to see that, for example, the 2 megawatt that have an diameter, have a ratio diameter grid spacing that is lower, converge as a worse conversion than the 4 megawatt case study. If we see the case study of the 4 megawatt scenario, we can see that using a grid spacing of 25 centimeter, the solution are supposed to be quite similar. But what we noticed was that for the 2 megawatt case study, despite the fact that the measure of turbulent resolution and Y plus reach an optimum value, the solution is not going to converge. And this is something that was a kind of strange, but this was what we found.
I think that's to do with the differencing scheme from experience.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I want to comment to be, maybe able to answer Nigel a bit. I think this is second order upwind scheme with predictor corrector for pressure.
So
they don't have third
order, and that creates instability.
It's second order definitely, and they don't have any way to play with the solver. They can only change Poisson solver for the pressure with some additional linked steps in the Poisson solver itself, but it's not that huge for them. Regarding the study, it's really interesting, and I wish it continued downwards with the meshes, like 10 centimeter, 5, maybe 1. If we
try to near the first source to.
Ah, but in the whole I understand that it's.
Near the first source and at the ceiling, where are the beams. But the MTR is still very high.
Yeah, I can't imagine.
So the problem is, if we. Probably sensitivity study implies a check of these trends, because we cannot replace the sensitivity study in terms of trends with a posteriori quality metrics like MTR and Y plus.
Yeah, well,
it would be very useful if we could be able to predict the reliability of the result in terms of MTR. But if MTR
I would go away from MTR and Y plus. I would focus on the convergence of the physical quantities that you measure to obtain like the same level of temperatures in the models. That would be interesting to find at which grid resolution the physical quantities begin not that dependent on the grid level.
Yes.
Now, regarding the MTR, it's also difficult criteria because it also only tells you how much of your turbulence energy is turned from very nice model into very bad model. So any value higher than like 0.2 is like really bad, and it should be avoided at all costs. And regarding Y plus, one thing that surprised me that you have mentioned that 1,000 is like acceptable value. And when we play with wind engineering, if we go anywhere above 30, they kick us out saying that's like terrible mesh. And but it's also dependent on temperature because of density. So in higher temperatures, the Y plus is also smaller. Did you check Y plus for ambient temperatures of these meshes, or?
We checked Y plus.
Just at the boundary.
Yeah.
Just about
the
boundary,
okay.
This could be a good idea also, just to place Y plus devices near the wall, and far from the wall, just to see.
Well,
it
only matters at the wall.
Yeah.
How away from the wall doesn't matter much. It's a wall function. I would love to see more dense meshes. If you struggle with computational power, we can work something out. I can lend you my HPC to play for that.
Yes, because we run that on our
little
computer.
In the UK, we would also use the D-star over delta X of 4 to 16.
Yes.
Very commonly used and very interesting to see your work says, yes, we need that, but still not necessarily anywhere near grid independence. Have you more detail on the methods that you're using? Do you have a paper written?
No.
We
are going to do that.
Yes.
The major question that we had also when we faced the rule of thumb was also that, for example, if we have a curve like this one, when the heat release rate changes a lot, is an ultra fast curve. Which heat release rate value should we put in the rule of thumb? So we did these case studies just to approach something that was more sophisticated than the use of rule of thumb.